your Savior. And when I was 17 years old, I chose Jesus to be my Savior. It didn't matter what happened, Jesus is my Savior. Well, that's the same way when you start praying for things or speaking things in your life. Whether it happens or don't happen, you keep speaking it, and eventually it will begin to happen. You see, one of the things about faith, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of the Lord. But if we look at the definition of faith, let me roll on. I've got my scripture, and so I don't have to carry my Bible with me. And usually it's quicker, but I know, let me find where I'm. Hebrews 11:1. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. But in the Hebrew, it says, now faith is the assurance, title deed, confirmation of the things hoped for, divinely guaranteed, the things, evidence of things not seen, the conviction of their reality. Faith comprehends as fact what cannot be experienced by the physical senses. So the biggest enemy you've got is when you begin to call those things that are not as though they are, or speak, you're speaking to your mountain, is your five senses. Well, Brother Keith, it's not happening. Brother Keith, you prayed for my belly. My belly's hurting worse today than it did when you prayed for me. Now, that's how the devil defeats you. I tell my people, and we see miracles all the time, okay? There's seven steps going outside our church. Our church is 112 years old, and I tell them your fate will be decided by those seven steps. Because we will pray for people in prayer lines, and we've prayed for as many as 600 people a night, and miracles will take place, healings will take place. They'll jump up and down. They'll run around. They are healed. And when they walk out on those steps, by the time they get to the sidewalk, they're either in a battle keeping their healing or they're losing their healing. You see, Brother Benny Hinn asked Brother Norville years ago to travel with him. Benny said, you know, I get miracles and healings all the time, because when you minister up here, you know whether a person receives that their healing or not. And he'll say, you know, they'll get healed and then they'll be back in 6 weeks, 6 months, asking me to pray for them again. You see, you have to know how to keep your healing. And the simple version of this, and here's another lengthy teaching if we were to get into it, is you got to learn how to talk. You see, when the devil tells you you've got COVID, you say, no, in the name of Jesus, I don't have COVID. When belly starts hurting, no, my belly does not hurt, in the name of Jesus. Well, Brother Keith, your lie, it's an earthly lie, but it's a heavenly truth, okay? You see, God's ways are not our ways. When that thought comes in, well, that guy, he's crazy. And that's going to come to you. When y'all leave here, the devil's going to talk to y'all and say, man, that guy's crazy. He can be. Now, you want me to tell you how you're going to find out is if you do what I tell you to do. Okay? But you've got to push through that. You've got to say, no, no, no. You see, you've got to want your healing more than failure. You see, most people are still in the realm of trying to prove that God is or isn't. Let me tell you a little secret about God. You're not going to prove God. God proves himself. Okay? So it doesn't matter how successful you are as you start. I can tell you, I've prayed. I've seen tremendous. I've seen third-degree burns leave my body and my daughter. My dad was 60% burned. 9 days later, walked out of a hospital, didn't have a scar on him anywhere, did not get skin grafts. Okay? The couple that was here last week with the three little girls, his mom and dad, 2 years ago, I believe we were down here. I prayed for them. We came down here, came back. She had stage 4 liver cancer. Nobody gets healed from that. You die from stage 4 liver cancer in 1 week, well, 12 days of being down, after being down here, get back, and she was totally healed. Okay? A year later, the husband came down with throat cancer and had a big tumor in his throat. We prayed for him on Sunday. Sometime the next week, they declared him healed of cancer. 2 weeks later, the big tumor that they were going to have to cut out just disappeared one day. Now, I can go on and on and on, okay? You heard Melissa's testimony. Why did that happen? Because I spoke to it. And I've learned something over the years. I forget. I may pray for you something big in your life today. The next week I won't remember. And that's good. Because you see, then the devil can't come back and try to bring doubt in. So sometimes used to, I wanted to know everything about you before I pray. Today I don't want to know nothing. All I just enough to know how to pray. Okay? Because it shuts the door. But you see, the church today is not seeing miracles and healings because the structure over them, the pastors and the leadership don't pray for people. So if they don't pray for people, the church doesn't pray for people. And that is why so many call me and say, "Will you pray for me?" I've got a friend up in West Virginia. We have prayed probably more than 100 people since I have met him, maybe closer to 200 people. All of them on their deathbed, and we've lost one in a period of 4 or 5 years. And I'm talking Lou Gehrig's disease. I'm talking heart failure. I'm talking autoimmune disease. And what's funny, the guy we just lost 2 weeks ago had autoimmune disease. He was literally dying. Each organ was shutting down. I prayed for him at 8 o'clock in the morning. They released him and declared him healed after me and Brother Cisco prayed for him that evening and said there wasn't anything wrong with him. Now, in less than 8 hours, totally healed, okay? Went home, spent the night with his family in good shape, nothing wrong with him, had a heart attack the next morning and died. So I didn't really lose him, you see. But you see, you get into this, I don't dictate, I'm not the healer. And you know, let me tell you what God's going to tell you. If you pray for somebody and they die, he'll tell you, well, that's between me and him. It's none of your business. Your job is to pray, okay, or to speak. And don't confuse the two, okay? So, and I could give you all kinds of scriptures, but I know Mabel's probably got some things, and we're probably going to show you how we spoke healing into Melissa's life. But life and death, Proverbs 18:21, life and death are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. Now, I'm going to read a couple of different translations of this. Life in the Amplified, it says, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it and indulge in it will eat its fruit and bear the consequences of their words. Now, you ever heard this? Little Johnny, don't you go out in that street, you're going to get run over by a car. You don't want to say those kind of words. And I talked about provoking your angels. You got to be very, very careful. You want me to tell you what? You got a guardian angel. My guardian angel has charge over me. His job is to take care of me. I don't say, well, I better not go out there, I'll get run over. You know why? Because the moment I do that, that angel will stand there and let me get run over. You see, he's activated by your words. Now, what I will say is I'm going to cross that street and my angels are going to protect me. You have to watch. Now, I'm not, my wife's more of a stickler on this than I am, because sometimes we say things in jest that we don't really mean and stuff. And I don't want to get legalistic about this, but I want you to understand, you have to watch what you say. Negative words will bring negative results, okay? Especially over your children, the people that you have authority over. Everything needs to be positive, but life and death is in the power of the tongue. Brother, how many of you have ever heard the term how to live and not die? You ever heard that? Dr. Norval Hayes, the guy that trained me, coined that phrase. He has a book, we just reintroduced it, How to Live and Not Die. He trained a young lady about her age. Her husband was dying, literally gasping for his last breath. And in 30 seconds, Brother Norval taught what I'm teaching here today to her a lot quicker than me. And that boy lived, you see. You see, you don't have to be an expert at things. You just got to know the basics, okay? We spend too much time trying to be an expert at it, and we need just to be doing. Okay, but you have to do it. And what he told her in 30 seconds as you get up and you walk around that bed and you declare, he'll live and not die in the name of Jesus. He'll live and not die in the name of Jesus. And he told her, he said, because you have authority over him because you're married. She had to do that for several days. And all of a sudden, he began to get better. And over about a week, week and a half, he ended up coming out of it. Now, Mabel was going to tell you in a minute how long she had to minister to Melissa to get her set free. You see, you hear these stories, well, I prayed for 25 years for this. Those are particular circumstances. And usually those people are being trained for something. Okay, and I could give you some, okay, if we talk about the unjust judge in Luke, he said, will not the Lord bring it speedily? Now, you're going to have to prove yourself to the Lord, okay? So there'll be a little time in there, but that you're going to have to say things. You're going to have to walk the floor, and you're going to have to say, by the stripes of Jesus, I'm healed. But don't think you're going to be at this for years and years and years. See, the greatest enemy that Satan has, and I'm amazed that the church, the big ministries don't touch on this, is his greatest weapon against you is time. You see, you and I are on a timeline. We're only on this earth so long. And if the devil can steal your time, he can defeat you. That's really the most serious weapon he has against you. So any time you get into something, don't begin to stand on it. Don't sit there and believe, well, this is going to take forever. I get people calling me wanting deliverance. And they'll tell me what type of situation they're in. And the Lord will begin to speak to me. Just pray for them now and I'll deliver. And I'll say, okay, now let me pray for you and we'll get you set. No. I got to come to new life and I'm going to have to spend 3 or 4 days. You're going to have to spend hours and hours praying for me. And the Holy Ghost sitting there telling me, if you'll just pray for them right now, I'll set them free. And you know what happens? Every one of them hang up on me. They won't let me pray for them, you see. You see, they'll listen to the devil, you see. There's people that will steal your time, okay? But you have to realize that don't get caught up in these little fallacies and tricks that it takes this and it takes that. Today, you got to know the names of all the devils and this and that. No, that's all a lie. There's times the Holy Ghost will tell me when I minister to somebody, cast the devil out, will say that he's got this spirit or that spirit. But here's the thing about it. All devils, when you use the name of Jesus and command them to go, must go, whether you know their name or not. You see, one thing about the story of the madman of Gadara is that Jesus was walking in the Old Testament. Today, you and I have the Holy Ghost, so I don't have to ask about those names. The Holy Ghost will tell me if I need to know it. See, a lot of people are making teachings out of things that doesn't need to be. Okay, Matthew 12:37, for by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. So this is, and I had a few other scriptures I could go over, but they're talking about speaking to the sycamore tree and speaking to the mountain. We have to learn how to speak to our problems. Now, the difference in me and most ministers is by being under, Brother Norwood, somebody come up here, I've seen him do it, just a person just tremendously disabled, and he'd pray for them and just miraculously they'd be healed. And I'm talking about you seeing, okay? Next night, another one would come in and he'd have somebody sitting on the stage or me or whoever and say, now it's your turn. Now, if you want to learn the hard way, hang around Brother Norman, because he expected you to go out there and pray and see that person healed just like that first one. And it's the same way with casting out devils. And you want me to tell you a little secret? If you did what he trained you, you'd see people get healed. Okay? You'd see devils flee. It's easy, guys, because you're not the one doing it. All you got to do is say it. Okay? But we got a little time. And but Melissa came in, and you've heard her testimony. She was diagnosed with bipolar, and I don't know if she said this or not, but I will tell you that, because I paid good money for what I'm about to tell you, is that no one ever gets healed of bipolar. That's what the doctors will tell you. She asked me, she said, what am I going to do? Because everybody's got a problem about faith and medicine. I said, you're going to keep taking the medicine until you can stand on your own. And, well, how long am I going to have to keep doing this? I said, about a year, until the doctor tells you that you're healed. Daddy, that doctor won't ever tell me that I'm healed because no one gets healed of bipolar. I said, he will you. And a year later, he told her she's healed. Okay? I'm not sitting here telling you I heard from on high and gave a great prophetic word. I told her what the word says. If you believe and you keep saying it, you're going to get it. So here's what I knew. If she was going to be healed, the doctor and the natural had to say she was healed. Right? You see, you got to reason some of this stuff out. So I told her, just keep taking the medicine. You know why I told her to keep taking medicine? Because it played with her mind so much she couldn't think. How are you going to speak to something if you can't even think about it? Right? You got to think every word you say. That's one good thing about the baptism of the Holy Ghost. You may not realize this, but and you can look this up on YouTube, but because a scientist actually did a test. There is no brain waves when you pray in the Holy Ghost. That means I can sit here and pray in the Holy Ghost for 3 hours and think about what I'm going to cook for lunch when I get back. You see, you can carry, if you could, it's hard to do, but you could carry another conversation on if you had another mouth. Okay? Literally, I mean, because there is no brain activity. But if you're going to speak in your natural language, you got to think about it. Well, she couldn't do that. She couldn't get up here by his stripes. I'm healed. Greater is he that's in me than he that is in the world. I'm more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus. She couldn't do that without that medicine. So here's where I'm at, guys. Now, and people, I couldn't tell you how many people I've heard, well, God told me not to take my medicine. You better take your medicine. No, God told me not to take my medicine. Okay, they're dead. You see, most people say they hear from God. No, they're hearing from their own self, okay? I hate to say that. They've not developed. If you're going to really hear from God, you're going to be a person that hears the word a lot because God speaks through his word in the beginning. And too many people today will claim to hear from God, but they're dying, okay? H. Richard Hall told the Lord one day, he said, I'm going to Arizona, I'm going to draw a big circle in the sand, I'm going to stand in the middle of that sand, and you're either going to heal me or you're going to kill me. He healed him. But now, H. Richard Hall was a mighty man of God. Okay? So my suggestion, if you've got something wrong with you, go ahead and take the medicine. Do what the doctors say. Because you see, God can use doctors just like he can anything. But I'm going to tell you a little secret. God's going to heal you over top of that doctor. And I want you to understand something. You're paying that doctor for a bad report. Never expect that doctor willingly to give you a good report. If he does, he's going to be talking about a miracle. Okay? So you got to keep all this in your head. Take your medicine, but here's the thing. Every time you hurt, by the stripes of Jesus, I'm healed. Thank you, Jesus, you're my healer. You don't have to be fancy about this. You just got to say it. I am healed in the name of Jesus. I am healed in the name of Jesus. You ever heard people talk about head on car wreck, and they just start saying, Jesus, 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 Jesus? Guess what? They're invoking the power of God into that situation. And all of them will tell you they live for it. There's power in that name. You got something, mate? Have to pull her out. I want to get her up here, and I'm going to show you how she walked, Melissa, in just a second. Because some, and people say, why do you do this, Brother Keith? Because Brother Norval taught me this way. And here's the thing about it. I don't want to say you're lazy, but you're intimidated, you see. What if somebody sees me? You know, one of the things that I need to do a study, you would be amazed in the New Testament that how many times Jesus talked about don't be ashamed of me. You see, I was Methodist. I'm going to tell you something right now. I was the world's greatest silent prayer. and I never got nothing. Now, the Lord talked to me because I was praying to him. But I didn't get no healings and miracles and stuff, okay? But when I began to speak it with my mouth, why? Because that was what the Word told me to do. But at the same time, now you know he's one of them guys that speaks with his mouth. You see, I'm no longer ashamed of who I am. You got to get up and you got to make yourself do something. Now, Brother Keith, I don't believe that. I'll sit right here. Okay, Ezekiel 16:49 tells you the sins of Sodom. Now, everybody in here knows that homosexuality and all that stuff was the sins of Sodom, except that was just part of it. The Solomon Temple in Jerusalem was destroyed because of the sins of Sodom. And if you read Ezekiel, if you read Isaiah, and you read Jeremiah, you will see this, okay? One of those sins is setting idol. I see good Methodists and Baptist people that know the Word, that love Jesus, that will sit in their pew until cancer kills them. They're sitting there idly, and God hates that. He wants you up. He wants you doing what you need to be doing. And I'm going to tell you something, and Mabel was the same way. Anointing will hit her in a minute. She'll get crazy. Well, one of these days that's going to happen to you. But you'll love it because you know when the power of God comes on you, things is getting ready to change in whatever you're praying about.
This young man confirmed the message that I have. Now, I'm the preacher. He's the teacher. I'm the preacher. He talked about the passion of the Lord. He's passionate about the Lord. Well, you know what? I call that the fire of God. The fire of God. We all need the fire of God to stir us up and to get us moving. If you think about a wildfire, people get excited. They start moving. They get up on their feet and they start moving and they start doing stuff. When you get the fire of God in you, you will begin to preach. You will begin to teach. In Jeremiah, he said, the word is in me like fire. He said, I can't contain it. When you get the fire of God in you, you will talk to people in the stores about Jesus. You will talk to people on the job about Jesus. When you get the fire of God in you, you will not be intimidated. John the Baptist came, and he saw Jesus, and he says, he's the one. I'm not even worthy to take his sandals off and carry them. And he says, he's the one that will baptize you in the Holy Ghost and in fire. We all need some fire in us. The Bible says in Isaiah, he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me to preach the good news and so on and so forth, and to give you beauty for ashes. Well, the fire of God will burn things out of you that need to be burned out, and some ashes will be produced, but the Lord, the Spirit of the Lord, and the fire of God will give you beauty in the place of those ashes. The fire of God will cause you to want to read your word. The fire of God, fire brings light. If you have the fire of God in you, your light for Jesus is going to shine brighter and brighter. People's going to see Jesus in you if you have some excitement and some fire in you. The fire of God will cause you to do things that you wouldn't ordinarily do. One time, the Lord sent me in. Now, I did a few times drink socially, I guess you'd say, a few times. But I was never a drinker, so I never had to get that out of my life. After I was born again, or Jesus didn't have to burn that out of me. But the fire of God placed in me one time to walk in to a beer joint and to rescue someone that was in bad, bad shape. Now, would I ordinarily do that? No. But the fire of God motivated me to do that. Whenever Melissa was sick, Melissa came up here. Whenever she was sick, and you know, the fire of God will cause you to cry out to the Lord. Cry out to the Lord. When blind Bartimaeus was very ill, he cried out to the Lord. And the people were saying, shh, shh, be quiet, hush, be quiet, be quiet. And what did he do? He cried out more and more. When Melissa was sick, she said, Mama, let me die. Just let me die. And it was a pity thing. She wasn't pity. Well, the people in college had And she came home, and I did everything I could in the natural to help her. But when she said, Mama, let me die, I said, no, you'll live and not die in the name of Jesus. Get up here. Get up here and walk and praise Jesus as your healer. And I said, say, Jesus, I love you. You're my healer. She said, Jesus, I love you, my healer. I had to make her do it. I said, no, you say it louder. You worship Jesus as your healer. I worship you, Jesus is my healer. And she began to do as I instructed her. And in just a few minutes, that heaviness lifted off of her. I only had to do that with her about 2 or 3 times. And then she got the word, the card that she talked about last week. But the word, Jeremiah said his word. Now Keith has talked about the word. The word, the word, the word. But you need the fire of the Holy Ghost to motivate that word in you. You need that word to set ablaze. His word was in my heart, burning like a fire, shut up in my bones. And I was weary of holding it back. Jeremiah was having to hold the word back. When you get the word in you and the fire of God in you, you cannot hold it back. You cannot hold it back. I'm a stoker. That's my job. I'm a stoker. When I go into churches, my job is to stoke the fire. My God is to stoke the fire in you today. The Lord sent me here to stoke some fire in you. You've got the word. You love Jesus with all your heart. You're seeking him. You love him, but he wants you to have his fire. He wants to baptize you afresh and anew in the Holy Ghost and fire. That's what some of you need today. We all need. The world pulls on us. It pulls on us. Our jobs pull on us. Our families pull on us. That's the reason we need a fresh touch and a fresh fire from the Holy Ghost. Amen? Amen.
Now, what you're asking, where can I start? How can I do this? She just covered that. You got plenty of things in your natural life you're going to have to pray about. Sickness, disease. Then one day you're going to run up to a friend in Walmart. You know, they diagnosed me with cancer. Blessing and cursings are in the power of the tongue. You can curse cancer and command it to die in that body, okay? You need to, and that's why you got to know the word and you've got to have the fire of God so that the boldness, okay, the might, you can pray for that. Okay, but you're going to have plenty of opportunities in your normal life to speak to those mountains. And those mountains are any problem you have. So you don't have to be up here and people, well, Brother Keith, you don't understand. We're not in a worldwide ministry. No, you're not. You're servants of God, and you're supposed to meet whatever need God brings before you. So go ahead, and we're going to run out of time in just a minute. Well, about 5 more minutes, Mabel, and we'll pray for people.
Fire symbolizes God's purifying presence, which burns away the undesirable elements in our lives and sets our hearts aflame to ignite in the lives of others. If you don't have fire in you, all of you got a spark. We've all got a spark because we've been baptized in the Holy Spirit. Amen? But we need that spark. Jesus said that, or John the Baptist said about Jesus, the winnowing fan is in his hand. So we need that spark. We need it. Wind on it. Life on it. Today. It purifies it. It makes us moldable. Fire, what does fire do to gold? It purifies it. And when gold is 100% purified, when it's 100% gold, it is not hard. It is very moldable. So the fire of God will mold us. And look, it only takes a little bitty spark to get a big old fire going, doesn't it? You know what? If one of you in here today got really on fire for God, you could change this whole church. You could change your whole community. You could change your family. You could change Myrtle Beach. That's right. It'll bring you protection. You know, in the Old Testament, they had strange fire. The fire of God will keep you from having strange fire. It will keep you from false doctrine. It will give you discernment. You will know in your heart when the fire of God's burning in you, not when someone says something that's not in line with word, you'll say, oh no, that doesn't sit right with me. That doesn't sit right with me. And it gives you light. And I want to tell you something else fire does. It cooks things. It makes things taste good. The fire of God makes the word of God taste good. The fire of God causes people to see in you that you have something that they don't have, and it will make them hungry. The word says, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Well, things that are cooked, fire cooks them. The fire makes things taste good. And when you have the fire of God in you, people will see that, and they will become hungry for what you have. Hallelujah.
Now, I know the other church is going to be coming in, and brother's going to come up in a minute. But if you have a need right now, I don't care what it is, if you want to come up and we'll pray for you. But let me encourage you, be a speaker to the mountain. You know, believing's great, but believing doesn't get you healed. Believing and speaking gets you healed, okay? What's in you must come out of you. You see, that is a process. I'll give you a little indication on tongues. You may not realize this. Jesus has said at the right hand of the Father making intercession. When you pray in the Holy Ghost, now there's four different gifts of the tongues. Some say five, but four to five. Okay, what you're speaking is the words that Jesus has given to the Holy Ghost for you to speak. And once you say it, now God then can act on it on this earth because you have dominion. A lot of people will say, well, God killed Sister Susie in a car wreck. That's a lie. God does not have dominion of the earth. For him to do anything on the earth, one of his servants on the earth has to speak it. And that's why you have to learn to speak to get something from God. Okay? You've got to open your mouth. But if you have a need, if I've got prayer cloths and I wire them, and we see tremendous miracles, but if there's a need here, we'll pray for you real quick, and then we'll turn the meeting over. So come up if you need prayer. Hallelujah. If you want the fire of God, then come up, and maybe we'll pray for you there. Come up here and lay your hands on her. She has cirrhosis of the liver. Father, I curse cancer in my sister's body right now. And I thank you for the anointing going into it right now in the name of Jesus. I curse this cancer. I command it to die. I command it to leave her body. And by the stripes of Jesus, she is healed, Lord. And Father, I thank you right now that you're a God of restoration, a creative God. And I call forth a miracle that everything that has been damaged or destroyed will be replaced and healed in the name of Jesus. I declare her healed by the stripes of Jesus, that she will get a good report from you, from the doctors, about you and what you've done in the name of Jesus. And I declare her healed in the name of Jesus of Nazareth right now, in the name of Jesus.
Thank you, every spirit, every demon in hell that has set this self against himself against this woman, I bind you and I loose you from all assignments over her body. By Jesus' stripes, she is healed. I speak healing into her body from the top of her head to the tip of her toes. I speak healing in Jesus' name. I call forth family members. She's got family members that she's been praying for, right? I call forth her family members into the kingdom of God. This woman has been, they've been heavy on her heart. She's been praying for them a long time. I bind the devils, and I command all spiritual blindness to be removed from all of her family members. And we loose angels to go set up the circumstances where laborers will be coming forth into their path with the fire, that have the fire of God, and that they can see the goodness and taste the goodness of the Lord in these people, and that they will become hungry and desire it, Lord, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we plead the healing blood of Jesus. We plead the healing blood of Jesus over this woman. From the top of her head to the tip of her toes, we plead healing. Healing blood, we plead saving blood of Jesus over her family, over all of her loved ones. Oh, Father, I pray you just put your arms around this woman and just love on her. I pray for fresh fire to come into her body, into her soul, into her mind like she has never experienced before. Oh, the fire of God, we call on the fire of God. Hallelujah, Lord. Fire, 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 fire in Jesus' name. Fire in the name of Jesus. Receive it, sister. Receive it in Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
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 Thank you,
Jesus.
Glory,
what
glory,
do you need? Hallelujah. Now I'm going to turn this over to brother right now, but I feel led, this young couple. As you study the word, Ephesians, the first chapter, the 17th verse, it goes like the Father will grant you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him. Now that translated in Mountain Talk is simply God's going to teach you the Bible the way He sees it. See, every denomination has their own teaching on how they see it. Well, that right there, Ephesians 1:17, Colossians 1:9, and Isaiah 11, all are scriptures that were and prayers that Paul prayed that tells you that God will teach you the word the way that He sees it. You want to pray that. Just say, Lord, and you don't have to get fancy. Just say, Lord, teach me the word the way you see it, and it will change your life. Hallelujah. Brother, if you won't come on up.
Thank you, Pastor Keith. We could all just say thank you to Pastor Keith for his wonderful message today. And remember, just like it says in Romans 10, that if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart, you will be saved. Same thing with your healing. If you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart, God will work wonders for you. I want to thank you for coming today to our church, those of us here and online. And remember, as you leave today, take His anointing to everything you do. Thank you, and we love you. Have a great day.